So welcome everybody, and we are very happy to have you here. And I know a lot of you really had a long trip to come here, but most of you made it. So I'm very happy that you are here, and like to thank the Volkswagen Foundation as well, that we have this very nice conference venue, and even the weather is becoming better. Slightly, but it's improving, and tomorrow probably the sun will shine the whole day. So today I will introduce some general remarks concerning the idea behind the conference, and so kind of the storyline for our conference. You don't have to stick to it, but it's just to make clear what we did intend by choosing this topic, and what kind of problems we are tackling with. So the title of today's talk of mine is Money is Only Half of the Story. And we are an interdisciplinary team of people from law school, criminal law, and criminologists and sociologists. And so we are trying to explain organizational wrongdoing and find out how to prevent organizational wrongdoing. And of course, as Braithwaite put it, we experience all over the world the return of the regulatory state. I don't know if it was gone, but now the state is back concerning laws and law enforcement in a very strong way. If we think at the new UK Bribery Act, for example, or if you think of South Korea and the retirement of Park Geun-hye, the president, because of corruption complaints. But of course, we also have in the United States, these are just the numbers for the FCPA cases, and you can see we have a rising number. The peak is during the global financial crisis, but still we have a rising number of concerning law enforcement of the DOJ and SEC. I don't know how the numbers will change after Trump, or with a presidency of Trump, but we will see. And of course, Brazil, where we really experience a new era of law enforcement. Probably some of you know Michel Temer, who was indicted for taking 11.5 million in bribes from a meatpacking company. And recently he was indicted again for obstruction of justice and racketeering. But so far as I know, the lower house didn't lift his immunity. So he is still president, and but it's not just Michel Temer. So you know, Lula was convicted in first instance. Now the case is at the appeal court, and we will see what happens. But altogether, we do have in Brazil five former and sitting presidents that are who are indicted. We do have 300 politicians under investigations, and already 133 managers and CEOs arrested. So there have been sentences of 15 CEOs with incarceration of up to 15 years. And that's quite something for Brazil. And would, of course, even be something for Germany. But in former times, there have been just rare cases of law enforcement concerning Brazilian take on corruption, the Brazilian take on corruption. And of course, we cannot compare China to Brazil because we don't know what's going on there really, if it's law enforcement or if it's political selection or what's behind those cases. But the anti-corruption policy still is quite strict in a sense that a lot of people are arrested. There are estimated number of 300,000 civil servants indicted or arrested. We have 140 people on minister level that are indicted or convicted already. And in former times, we've done a study of CEOs in mainland China, and out of a sample of 150 CEOs, 40 have been indicted or arrested of our sample. You see, there's a lot of anti-corruption campaign is going on, and even the mistresses of the Chinese functionaries are now moving to California. So the concubine system was part of the anti-corruption policy in China. So how effective is the regulation boom concerning organized crime, corporate crime, and political corruption? I think that's kind of one of the leading questions and the puzzling question for all of us. And of course, we have to think about it, because if we check on the new numbers concerning organized crime in Germany, and you see this is the map with the hotspots of Italian organized crime. So IOC is not the abbreviation of the International Olympic Committee, but of the Italian organized crime. And you can see we have a rising numbers of active members of the mafia in Germany. So the estimation is from 2008, 136 to 2017, 562 members of the IOC, Italian organized crime. And the Cosa Nostra experience, the 520% of growth, and then 455% of growth. So why is it so difficult to deal with Italian organized crime? And we are not specialists concerning that, but from a sociological perspective, the Italian mafia is organized crime, but it's not an organization. So just imagine the classic structure of the Italian mafia, if it would be a university or the Volkswagen Foundation. So, and you would have newly recruits, you have a ritual. So how was it? The Archangel Gabriel, and you take your knife and you have, you know, a drop of blood, and they will tell you, your flesh will burn, and you will burn in hell if you don't follow the rules of the mafia. So you have oath, blood, ritual, agreement to obey. All these things is not an entry I mean, we wouldn't do that with our students, right? So it would be kind of strange because usually you use contracts, right? And you can decide if you keep the contract or if you exit. And you know, exit also is not so easy. Concerning the Italian mafia, mostly it's a lethal exit. So they kill you, or you're going to a witness protection program, and then still we have some quotations from mafia hitmen telling us, God will forgive, but the mafia will not. So they are still thinking the mafia will come after them and kill them. And if you look at the membership, of course, it has nothing to do with an organization, because you are totally absorbed. Not just, we call it total inclusion. It's not just you, it's also your family. And you have this blood feud principles, you have strict obedience. And of course, part of the purpose of organized crime are criminal activities. So it's not good if you say, I won't kill him, right? So you have kind of an obligation to act in a criminal way. So you see, this is kind of a traditional form, like secret societies in former times. And in our perspective, this is also one of the reasons, just one of the reasons, why it's so difficult to fight organized crime. Because you need people who are willing to risk their lives to fight organized crime, or to live for the rest of their lives with bodyguards, which is also not easy to take. So people like Roberto Scarpinato. Okay, but usually we are not dealing with organized crime, but with organizational crime. So what are the preconditions of organizational wrongdoing if you have like companies, hospitals with legal purposes using illegal means sometimes? So that's a difference from organized crime. What are the pattern behind? And in our approach, we have a multi-level approach. So we are checking on institutions, on the environment, on what we call unwritten rules inside the companies and hospitals, and on the actors, what are the factors guiding the behavior of the actors. And of course, the Volkswagen Foundation is fully independent of the Volkswagen concern, and we are 100% scientific, of course. But let's take the Volkswagen company and the Dieselgate as an example to make clear what we are talking about. Most of us from Germany know the Diesel Summit a few weeks ago. And this was, on the one hand, great drama, but well-versed chess as well, because you now get an environmental premium. If you scrap your old car, and you can buy a new diesel car, if you like to, and you will get up to 8,000 euros discount, so you can buy low-priced cars. Now we do have real driving emission tests, we have funds for the cities, and a software update. So this sounds quite well. And it was a brilliant move, but as Angie said, she doesn't want to have hardware retrofits. So to just go for environment protection, you need to have that. So the whole thing is just to keep the car making industry running. And this is, of course, part of the regulation in the United States. It's completely different, but part of the regulation in the European Union and in Germany. Because for us, institutions are defective and regulations are defective when there are laws and directives, let's say exhaust gas standards, but no sufficient standards or effective enforcement. So the European Union regulations did open up the door because you could have defeat devices to protect the diesel engine. So, and that's what most of the car makers, not all, did. So institutions are defective when the constitutional legal base are not undermined, but the purpose, which is environment protection, of the regulation is largely missed. Okay, deviant environment. The second feature we have to talk about. The automobile industry is a kind of a good example for an environment prone to deviance. Because even Volkswagen did use sensor systems for temperature to control emissions in 1974. They got caught with the Volkswagen Beetle, which is one of the famous Volkswagen cars. And the fine was $120,000. And then you can see we have the who is who of the car making companies, Chrysler, Ford, GM, Toyota, GM, Ford, Honda. Then you have the truck companies, BMW. And 2004, we had Audi and Volkswagen again, who started to use these defeat devices. So the preconditions for this kind of deviation from rules have been quite clear. And Dieselgate is, in our perspective, an example for organizational deviance. I tell you why. Because as far as we know, no illegal personal gains are involved. So the people kind of installing that defeat device as the software engineers and so on, they didn't get any illegal personal gain out of the story. They did it mostly, as far as we know, if we check on the records, they did it mostly for the sake of the company. And of course, they had legal incentives to have their career. They had bonus systems. And it all was dominated by a legal gray zone of activities, which led to a normalization of corruption. So it was not about rational choice. It was about, you know, getting used to a system where deviation from rules, at least concerning the United States, did become a normal behavior. There was a subculture, and even the emails of the software engineers sent to their supervisors didn't lead to any reaction. So they kind of kept it in secret what was going on, and reacted, you know, very late when the ICCT did show what is about the emissions and the defeat devices. They do have high-ranked insiders. You know, this is part of the career system. So most of the people on the senior executive level have a job tenure of 20 to 30 years. So you have high-ranked insiders, expectations from the top, and of course, a neglection of consequences. Because the consequences of this environment pollution are very abstract. You know, it's not very concrete. Someday someone will die because of cancer. So we are not very good in dealing with long-term consequences, and if they are abstract, it's even worse. So we have a strong neglection of the consequences. All this makes up a pattern, what we call organizational deviance, and where we try to find out how strong it is and how it's combined with individual deviance, with people getting kickback money, using provisions, shell firms to realize illegal personal gain. So the last question concerning this conference will be how to prevent, how to identify, and how to prosecute organized and organizational crime. I think this is a tough question, and usually we are dealing kind of with the prevention of individual behavior. So it's like you have so many rules now to comply with, and zero tolerance of the big companies. And we all have this nicely dressed compliance systems inside the companies, and whistleblowing and so on. But for us, there's another side of the coin, and this is what we call structural prevention, where we can see what are the structural preconditions and how can we prevent the structural preconditions for a higher risk, a higher probability that the company, the hospital, or the university will deviate from rules. And it's just to mention a few things, like inside career systems, the whole thing, the whole setting changes if you have outsiders involved. You have the building up of social cocoons, subcultures, and most of the companies have far too many rules. And if you have too many rules, the incentives rise to deviate from the rules. So then you kind of earn and it leads to a higher risk of organizational crime. Oh, there's something wrong. But anyway, I'm done. Many thanks, and I hope we all have a nice conference and enough time to discuss these questions. Many thanks, and welcome again.